Bullying. You heard this word many times before. To you, the first thing you think of is the person who you bully, who bullies you, or someone you've seen get bullied. What I think of when I hear this word is innocent victims being made fun of because the way they dress, the way they talk, because the way they are. Bullying affects victims in many ways. They act depressed, they isolate themselves, and don't check social media because they think another rumor has started about them. Bullying can cause self-harm, such as cutting, alcohol, drugs, and suicidal thoughts or actions. Bullying affects people during school as well. It makes victims not want to show up to school. They become edgy and do not focus in class. Bullying hurts people. The facts are in the numbers. Under 60,000 kids each day skip school to avoid bullies. One out of every four kids have been bullied. 20% of the victims consider suicide. Out of all suicide-related deaths, nearly 10% of those deaths are due to bullying. One story that really hit me was the story of Jaheim Herrera. He was a kid who woke up, ate breakfast, and went to school like a normal kid would. His mom had noticed something strange about him that day, but never said nothing about it. She knew he had been bullied before in school. She reported it. Nothing happened. She never thought it would get this bad. After school, he came home, brought a report card full of A's and B's. He went to his room while his mom made dinner. When she went to go get him for dinner, she found him hanging by his belt. He was only 11 and in sixth grade. Now you can see how this affects people. We could prevent this by being kind to one another, be a friend to a victim, and intervene if you can. This speech is also for the teachers. Did you know 9% of teachers have actually intervened during bullying, while only 90% have actually intervened? If we all work together, we can get rid of this epidemic.
The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. These famous words were quoted by none other than FDR, one of our most famous presidents. No offense, Mr. Roosevelt, but I beg to differ. Saying you don't fear anything except for looking scared won't make you seem brave. In fact, it could be quite the opposite. Now we all know about fear. It's when your worst nightmares come true. But there are so many different kinds of phobias that you can't even begin to name them all. Some, however, include acleophobia, the fear of the dark, and ephobiphobia, the fear of teenagers. I think your teachers are familiar with that one. The phobias can get even weirder, however, with the monster of them all, hexacosiohexacontahexaphobia, the fear of the number 666. Now you may be giggling, but this is no laughing matter. Fear can alter you. Have you ever heard the victims of a car crash tell the story? It usually goes something like, time slowed down, right? That's because of fear. Phobias can cause other things as well. You know how you always thought anger was an emotion by itself? Guess again, anger actually resonates off of fear. So the very thing that keeps two opponents bloodying each other in a fight is the fear of losing. Fear raises your blood pressure and depletes your immune system. It's not the end of the world if you get scared by something, people. In fact, there are a few ways you can come to terms with your inner scaredy cat. Now, fear isn't a disease. It's part of you. In other words, why hide yourself? If you really, really want those scares to soften, though, here's a tip. Get rid of that ego. Your ego makes you go, am I the best? Am I the best? I want to be the best. It'll make you do anything, even fight, to claw your way to the top. Another tip, materialistic values and fear go hand in hand. Losing your car, your job, your money, your clothes, your hand. It'll all eat you away if you get too attached. I'm not asking you to turn into hippies, but I'd rather let go than live in the dark, wouldn't you? As you can see, fear plays a huge role in our lives. But wait, what if we didn't think of fear as fear? What if, instead of being the power that held us back, fear was the energy that allowed us to do what we wanted? The energy to skydive. The energy to jump off a cliff. The energy to face those teenagers. If I had one thing to say to Mr. Roosevelt, it'd be, maybe fear is more than just a weakness. But to you all, I ask, will you let fear ruin your life?
Don't you love reading? Ever since you were little, your parents read stories to you before you would go to bed. You would visualize it all in your head and then dream about it in your sleep. You would imagine a handsome prince with chestnut hair, emerald green eyes, tall, and a smile that could light up your most darkest days. He would return to rescue a lovely princess that had long, curly hair that looked like spun gold, shining eyes the color of sapphires, and a round, rosy face. You would imagine a monstrous crimson dragon with bright jade eyes and needle-like claws. All of this is subsequent to the power of reading. Books can take you to a much higher level and teach you many things about life. They can either inspire you, give you more creativity in your writing, or maybe just help you pass time. Either way, reading plays a very important part in life. It helps you succeed and learn. For example, if you couldn't read, then how would you write? You would be illiterate. That's why schools encourage students to read, read, read. They do this because not only is that their jobs, but it will help the student to be successful later on in life. The brilliant thing about it is that there are books that will adjust to almost everyone's taste. There's scientific fiction, fantasy, biography, realistic fiction, and plenty more. There are also series of books, such as Harry Potter, Twilight, The Hunger Games. But of course, there are much more out there that are dying to be read. Series are my favorite kind of reading. A variety of them are greatly interesting, in my opinion, and leave the reader hungry for more. Reading also helps you comprehend and acquire new information. For instance, if you had a school assignment on someone's biography, you would have to do some research and take in the specific person's information. To do that, you have to know how to understand what you are reading and to take the most important things, such as the main ideas and supporting details, so that you can summarize it up in your head and realize the main point of what you're reading. Most of the time when you read, the author likes being specific and tends to choose good use in words. So when you think about it, it's like this little movie going on in your head. I have also noticed that reading can change your perspective on life. It can either influence you to try harder and achieve more goals, or it can influence you to have a better view of yourself as a person. It all depends on what type of book. In conclusion, reading can be so much more than simply some words on a page. No, instead, it's like a whole new world, and you get to see everything that happens. Next time you pick up a book and start reading, you're already a whole lot smarter than you think.
Did you do your homework?
Yes, Mom.
Have you been working on your book report?
Yes, Mom.
Honey, I picked you up this FCAT practice book from the teacher store, and it has all these...
Great. I am so excited.
My mom is a teacher. She's great to have around when I need help studying and for the ins and outs of school. But she constantly nags on me about my homework and even tells her students stories about me. Having your mom as a teacher can be good, bad, or flat out embarrassing. Like I said, it's good to have your mom as a teacher. To be a teacher, you obviously have to be very smart. Therefore, she helps me with a lot of my schoolwork. If I don't understand a lesson, she reteaches it to me until I finally get it. She also has me make notebook or PowerPoint presentations to study. That's a good thing because I get good grades, but it can take forever. She also helps me stay organized with just about everything. And if I'm not organized, watch out. I'll get an earful about the importance of staying organized. Peggy, when I come home, you better be working. Have you even started your homework? What happened at school today? Constantly asking about school. Constantly. It's also bad when she tells you, come to my school and help me work. We get to her school. She sends me down to the kindergarten classroom to read to them. I walk in and their big, bulging eyes are staring me down with their titanic smiles. Over an hour later, I've read 3 books, helped them learn about money, and answered countless questions as they swarm around me. What did I get myself into? My mom can be so embarrassing with her little Peggy stories. Don't even get me started on the stories she tells her students. She says things like, and on our last vacation, Peggy fell backwards off her snowboard and stormed down the mountain. Great, Mom. I want all your students to know that I fell off my board. don't forget about the baby pictures on her desk, where people can walk right into her classroom and look at me when I was in pre-K and kindergarten. What a joy to know that her whole entire school knows what I looked like when I was little. Having your mom as a teacher can be good, bad, or embarrassing. Lucky me, I get all three of these amazing qualities. But I realize that having your mom as a teacher isn't just about the bad or embarrassing things, it's about the good things too. It's not many people that have teachers in their family, so I feel like I'm a very lucky kid. Peggy, is your Tropicana speech finished yet? Yes, Mom, it is.
Whoa, you saw that, right? You know what I'm talking about, that thing that catches your eye right when you walk in the room. Come on, that splatter, that spark and burst of colors and designs, that explosion of creativity. Creativity-iveness is just that. The official, sophisticated, serious definition of creativity is the ability and quality to create something new and brilliant. Creativity is important in life, because without that extraordinary spark, there'd be no laughter. And without laughter, there'd be no happiness. And the world would be just like District 12 in the Hunger Games during the raping. Plain and sad. Why does this matter, though? This matters because sometimes creativity is an issue in middle school. So many students are falling into the things of society. They think that unique is what everybody else is doing. Some even think that people pay more attention to the kids who are wearing what everyone else is wearing. Just think, I noticed the students who are wearing something new and brilliant. What about you? This brings me to my next subject. How does being the weird one or the odd one out help you in school? First of all, I know you all are considering what I'm saying about creativity-iveness, but you're probably thinking, well, I just want to fit in and make real normal friends. In continuation, creativity doesn't mean you have to be all glitter and crazy colors, nor does it mean you have to be all on the different side, like going all goth or anything, because last time I checked, creativity is about not letting society get in the way of brilliance. Oh, burnt to society. Back on track, creativity helps you in school because it helps you look at things in a more differently amazing perspective, helps you think of things in a more deeper way. Because not only will creativity make you a more brighter student, but it will build up your self-confidence. Creativity helps you look at things in a more differently amazing perspective, helps you think of things in a more deeper way. Creativity is the aspect that will make you unique, not what society will tell you it's cool, because, by the way, cool is way overrated by now. Just saying. My point is that creativity builds up your self-confidence and helps you become more aware of yourself. So, now look around the room. You see that splatter, that spark, that explosion of creativity? It starts with you.
My speech is about Albert Einstein. Albert Einstein was born in Ulm, Germany on March 14th, 1879. He was brought up in a middle class upbringing. Although he was Jewish, he went to a Catholic elementary school. He wasn't very good in school except for mathematics. One of his teachers even said that he would never amount up to anything. Well, obviously she was wrong. Albert Einstein, starting as early as age 10 to 12, Albert Einstein was amazed with the mysteries of science. He always worked and worked. Albert Einstein was always amazed when his father first gave him his first compass. He was amazed that the needle always pointed north, whichever way he moved it. His father explained the theory of relativity, not relativity. His father explained the theory of magnetism. His main studies were mathematics and physics, and he solved some of the greatest mysteries of the universe. As you know, physics is the study of matter, energy, motion, electricity, light, sound, and magnetism. When Albert got stumped, he would just take out his violin and play until he found the answer. He played the violin a lot while creating his theory of gravity. In 1916, in Berlin, his theory of relativity was published. He had two wives and a son by each wife. Of course, he was a genius, but he was much more than that. He hated violence and fought for peace in the world. He wanted to ensure a better life for Jews. Today, physicists continue working on Einstein's ultimate dream of the theory of everything, an optimistic explanation of the whole cosmos.
I wake up in the morning to complete silence. I walk into the bathroom where my mom is taking a shower. I don't hear a thing. My brother has the TV on, still not a sound. Then I walk over to the counter where I keep my cochlear implants and I put them on. Suddenly, the morning bursts with sound. Have you ever wondered what it's like to be deaf? I'm Linnea Haga, and just to let you know, most of the speech is written from personal experience. Yes, I'm deaf. No, I don't know why. I was born deaf. I can hear because of my cochlear implants. You don't know what they are? Well, they're electronic devices that are implanted under the skin and in the bone of the head. When I wear the part that sits on my ear, I can hear. At school, I wear an extra part called an FM system. One part, the microphone, goes around the teacher's neck like a necklace. The other part plugs directly into my cochlear implants. When the teacher talks and magnifies the sound directly into my hearing, it helps me hear the teacher better. Plus, when I go to the bathroom, I don't miss anything because I can still hear the teacher. About 188,000 people worldwide have received their implants. In the United States, about 41,500 adults and 25,500 children have received their implants. About 2 to 3 out of every 1,000 kids born in the US are born deaf or hard of hearing. Out of that, 9 out of 10 are born to 2 normal hearing parents. That's why this technology is so important to everyone, and I hope we continue research in the field of hearing. Now, some people may feel sorry for me. Thanks, but you don't have to. I even like being deaf. One thing, it means I always have complete quiet when I sleep, no matter what. Also, when my brother gets too annoying or loud, I just turn off my hearing. Na 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 na, I can't hear you. So you got all that? What cochlear implants are? Yes? Good, now you know all about it, so you don't have to pelt me with a ton of questions. Yes, I'll have these for the rest of my life. Does it bother me? No. I can hear, and that's all that matters. I'd like to thank scientists and researchers, and of course, my surgeon, Dr. Bartels, for the miracle they have given me. I can hear.
Do you know what doomsday prepping is? If you don't, or even if you think you do, listen up. A lot of dedication and preparation is required to be an excellent prepper. There are many reasons that people prepare. Some reasons are devastating natural disasters, oil shortages, solar electrical magnetic pulses, and the end of the world as we know it. The wonderful thing about being a doomsday prepper is that if you are two, or 102, then you can start preparing. The 4 steps to being a doomsday prepper is stocking up on food, securing weapons and protection, your bug out plan, and developing amazing physical strength. The first step to being a doomsday prepper is stocking up on food. You need to have a plentiful supply of food and water. Your food and water supply should last you for about 6 months. Preserve healthy foods like proteins and vegetables. No candy and soda. They're not good for you. The second step to being a doomsday prepper is your weapons and protection. You need to stock up on weapons and ammo because you never know how badly the people want what you have. Your house should be protected with alarms and motion detectors. It's also a good idea to bulletproof your house. If the power goes out, then it's a good idea to have alternative power sources such as windmills and solar panels. The third step to being a doomsday prepper is your bug out plan. You need to have a vehicle that is gassed up and ready to go. You also need to be able to load all of your equipment into your vehicle in less than 1 hour. You need to have a spot where you and your prepping partners will meet, preferably a remote area where nobody will know where you are. Be able to sustain yourself for a few weeks, just until everything settles down. The final step to being a doomsday prepper is developing amazing physical strength. You need to train to be in shape. Don't sit on your couch. Also, go to the gym as much as possible. Be able to walk and run long distances. If you are in poor health, remember, it is survival of the fittest. Now that you have just heard the steps to becoming a doomsday prepper, do you think you have what it takes? There are many reasons that people prepare. You might even have your own reason. Now everyone, get up off of your chairs and start prepping.
There are many questions in this world, such as, why is the sky blue? Why do I have six fingers? Why are my pants wet? But a rather uncommon question is, what is a brony? Well, a brony is a combination of two words, bro and pony. No, it's not a male horseback rider. A brony is a grown man who watches My Little Pony. I'm not joking. Wait, don't get the wrong idea. It's not what it looks like. My Little Pony has become an international phenomenon. Okay, so it all started way, way back in the ancient times of 1990. My Little Pony Tales was released, and it was the stupidest show ever. So it was canceled. Hasbro tried again, but the attempt failed. It was decided that a My Little Pony television show was not meant to be. So no one ever tried again until Lauren Foss came along. She wanted to make a new show for Hasbro, but it would definitely not be the stereotypical girly kind of show that the others were. According to Foss, in My Little Pony Tales, they would have endless tea parties, giggle over nothing, and defeat villains by crying or sharing with them. Hasbro approved the show, and it aired on The Hub October 10th, 2010. Or 10-10-10. And thus, My Little Pony Friendship is Magic was born. As you all now know, The Mare and the Moon aired on 10-10-10. In its very first episode, Twilight Sparkle, a young unicorn, moves from Canterlot to Ponyville with her personal assistant, Spike, a baby dragon. She is a student of Princess Celestia, kind rule of Roequestria, which is the magical land where all the talking ponies live. Despite Twilight's antisocial behavior, she meets five new ponies. Rarity, the unicorn with a passion for fashion. Rainbow Dash, the Pegasus in charge of Ponyville's weather. Then, of course, there's Applejack, who is the apple-bucking cowgirl from Sweet Apple Acres. And Fluttershy, the kind, sweet, but timid Pegasus. Then last but not least, there's Pinkie Pie, the party-throwing party animal. The six ponies then embark on an adventure of epic, yes, I mean epic, proportions to save Equestria from Nightmare Moon, Princess Celestia's jealous sister. So this is where the first episode ends. It's just a whole beginning of a whole new series of awesome! This show has changed the lives of the hundreds of thousands of bronies and Pegasus sisters who are watching it right now. Will you join us and live ponily ever after?
Natural disasters happen all over the world. As children, we don't watch the news and are too busy playing around to even consider that all around us, news is happening. From hurricanes to tornadoes, earthquakes to tsunamis, these disasters happen all over the world. As good citizens of the planet Earth, we should be aware of what's happening outside our bubble we call the USA. I think we should offer our hearts and prayers to those who need it. On March 11, 2011, Honshu, Japan was hit by a 9.0 magnitude earthquake, which brought a 23-foot tsunami that took cars and buildings out to sea. 15,836 were found dead, and 5,936 were injured, and 3,640 were never found. Yet out of the horrid disaster, a search party swept Japan and found a 6-month-old baby girl, unharmed and alive. Without the efforts of the search party, the baby would have died. In the face of incredible odds, this group worked together to save lives. Also, in the year 2010, an earthquake measured 7.0 magnitude destroyed Lyogen, Haiti, and 300,000 people died, and it left 1 million homeless. But while other superstars were only concerned about being rich, Sean Penn, a famous actor, gave an example for us by using his star power to move the hearts of our international community when he talked about the earthquake in Haiti. Lastly, I would like to bring to your attention to the earthquake that came from China on May 18th, 2008, which is tomorrow. Almost 70,000 people died from the Sichuan earthquake. 374,176 were injured. After the word spread global, local and foreign artists donated their paintings to auction off for money to rebuild China. Natural disasters can happen anywhere in the world. Here in our country, we can't blind ourselves to think of the disasters of the magnitude we saw in Japan, Haiti, and China can't happen here. Just like rescue teams, movie stars, and artists, we need to provide our talent to help others. And with this, I say, we can make a difference.
Imagine you're holding a book.
Wait,
scratch that. Imagine you're reading that book. In fact, it's your favorite book. What's your dream book? Some people might say a Twilight book or a book from that series. Some might say a Harry Potter book or, most recently, a book from the Hunger Games trilogy. Of course, people will say other books or series, but why? What makes these books so different, and why do we all seem to imagine different books? Some people might answer this question with a simple, I don't know, or very harsh, I don't really care. Well, some people like myself will really ponder this question. Is it our gender? Could it possibly be because of hormonal differences that the boy or girl appear to attract to different book genres? However, this theory has been disproven in many cases. The book The Hunger Games had what appeared to be an equal number of boys and girls reading the book, even myself. If it isn't gender, could it possibly just be the content of the books? If my guess is right, most, not saying all, but most girls tend to go for a more amorous or romantic type of book. Also, boys tend to stay on the side of books with action. Am I right, boys? However, this is not always the case. Plus, some genres such as comedy, both boys and girls read. Could it be where you live that a certain book is restricted from your area or even your country? Bum, ba, ba. Or is it that a reader just doesn't live near a bookstore? Well, this might just be a personal issue of how a reader reads a book or how they get it. It never suggests if the reader likes the certain book or not. Could it be that a person feels obligated to if most of their friends have read the book and liked it? No, if a reader doesn't like a book, it is a voice of their own opinions. You shouldn't have to like what you don't want to like. Could it be the author? Could it just be the way that they write to us that impresses us? This may very well be the case. You see, a lot of people I know have favorite authors and read most of their books. Personally, mine is Rick Riordan. Rick Riordan is the author of the Percy Jackson and the Olympian series, the Heroes of Olympus series, the Kane Chronicles series, and the first book to the 39 Clues series. Many of you may know these books or series from reading them over the years. You see, these might be just some, but not all, the reasons that boys or girls read different books and see book genres differently.
Designer Yves Saint Laurent once said, "Fashion fades, style is eternal." I plan on becoming a designer one day, so I try to know trends. My true idol is Betsy Johnson. She has had some insane points of view on clothing and accessories, but that's why she's famous. The items she has created are not nearly as silly as a few trends we have seen over the years. Speaking of crazy, the bustle. Oh my. The bustle is a framework in the back of a woman's skirt to show the cut of a dress. Blah, blah, blah. Basically, it's a cage over your butt. I mean, why would you want a funky contraption emphasizing your rear end? This wacky fashion started in the 1860s and never really ended until the early 1900s. That is a long time for a woman to walk around looking ridiculous. Like, really, how did they sit? Before I go on and on about how tremendously weird that is, I'm just going to move on to my next subject, platform shoes. OMG. These shoes were made with thick soles that were at least 4 inches high. Think Lady Gaga. One time I saw her wobbling around in crazy stilt shoes that were like this high. Would you have guessed these gaudy wacko shoes would have been used for raising the height of important characters in ancient Greek theater? But found most popular in the 60s and 70s. These shoes were mostly worn by women, but could also be found on men. Yes, I said it, men. Imagine some guy walking around in 8-inch platform heels. Enough said. Speaking of the 60s, I have to discuss bell-bottom jeans. These jeans started out in the early 1900s as a uniform for the Navy that flared out at the bottom into a bell formation. No one knows why exactly they wore them that way, but they became popular again in the 60s. These jean bottoms could be like a foot or more wide. What purpose could there be to wear them aside to use them to sweep the floor? What you may not know is bell bottoms evolved into a popular style you might just wear today, bootcut jeans. Obviously, we have had very many crazy design ideas. A few included the bustle, remember the butt cage, the Gaga wobblers, aka platform shoes, and the navy super pants. Well, bell bottoms. Coco Chanel says fashion has two purposes, comfort and love. Beauty comes when fashion succeeds. I agree with her. Thank you.
Let Goody Martin rest in peace. I never knew her harm a fly, and witch or not, God knows, not I. I know who swore her life away, and as God lives, I'd not condemn an Indian doll gone war to them. That was a poem written for Susanna North Martin by John Witter. Susanna North Martin was born in England on September 30th, 1621. Susanna was hung on July 19th, 1692 in Salem when she was 71 years old. Susanna's life was more of a tragedy than a happy ending. In 1669, Susanna was first formally accused of witchcraft by William Sargent Jr., but since there was no evidence, she was found innocent. Years later, she was trialed again, and this time found guilty in Salem, Massachusetts. These trials are known today as the Salem Witch Trials. The story behind this catastrophe was that the minister's daughters got in trouble and lied, saying that witches had been casting spells on them. And if they refused to confess, they'd be killed by hanging, drowning, or burning. Sadly, in Susanna's case, that is exactly what happened. Back then, people were very superstitious, especially when the girls that were accusing everyone were the minister's daughters, so everyone had to believe them. Susanna Martin lived a long life that ended in a very tragic way, and so did the hundreds of others accused of the exact same thing. But my question is, was there anyone that expected the girls to be lying?
Well, I guess I'll never know. Susanna North Martin is not just a piece of American history, but she is my 10th great-grandma, so that means a lot to me.
Do you want to be on television or in the movies? To be able to do this, you need to know how to act. Being on television and in the movies isn't as easy as it looks. It's a lot of hard work to be an actor or an actress. There are so many things you need to learn. I love acting so much, and there are so many reasons why I do. The first reason I like acting is because I love to be in front of people. Also, acting is an amazing way to express yourself and relate whatever you're acting into to real life. Like if you're doing a sad scene, then you can think of a sad time in your past, and it will bring out more of your emotions. Now, acting isn't all about the money and fame you may get from it, and you shouldn't do it for any of those reasons. You should act because it's what you want to do. Another thing that's important is auditioning. An audition is when you try out for a role in a play, show, or movie. Now, don't get too excited. You usually won't get the job on the first try. Auditioning is much harder than you think, and you might have to go to over 100 auditions to get one yes. This will occur after a bunch of no's. However, if you keep on trying, always do your best, and practice, 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 then you will succeed. Acting is also an amazing way to meet new friends. When you take acting classes, you meet lots of people that love acting just like you. Doing acting activities and games are so much more fun when you're doing them with a room full of people your age. There will be people that are having just as much fun as you are playing the acting games and doing lots of activities. Did you know that there are also different kinds of acting? There's theater acting, which is plays, television acting, and commercial acting. They're all very different, but all extremely fascinating and fun. In theater, if you mess up during a performance, keep on going. You're in front of a lot of people, and it's better just to say your line wrong than to stutter and say, With television, it's a little bit different. If you mess up, then you can just do it over again, and you're not in front of a lot of people like you are in theater. In commercial acting, you're trying to sell a product. You have to do everything you can to act like you absolutely love whatever you're selling. All these types of acting are really, really cool. These are all the reasons why I love acting so much. It's a big part of my life. Acting is so much fun, and I just, well, love it. After this speech, I hope you like acting too. Even if you don't, I hope next time when you're watching television, you think of how hard all those actors are working and that it is not as easy as it looks.
You know that little spark of adrenaline you get when you have a mini heart attack, drop 200 feet riding a roller coaster, or maybe you only drop 3 feet off your bed. At least I know I do. Surfing is just like that, only 10 times better. Surfing is great, but there's some things you need to learn before you go. The first thing you would need to learn are what waves to go on. The better waves to go on are the nice, almost breaking waves. Do not ride the already broken waves. They won't take you very far. And remember, the bigger the better. The bigger they are, the longer it'll take for them to fall. The second most important thing to surfing basics is how to correctly stand on your board. Now, first you have to find a wave. And if you can't find any, you're probably in the wrong spot. Now, when you find a wave, you have to paddle towards the beach. The trick to paddling is to cup your hands and dig down deep. Then you have to pop up. Pop up means you do a push up on the board, slide your feet under you, then spin it out to whatever side feels more comfortable. Now safety, 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 safety. That is definitely the most important part to surfing basics. Now, there are jellyfish and they will sting. The most powerful one in the area is the Portuguese man of war, and they're anywhere in Florida, so be careful. And riptides. If you get caught in one, and you know when you do, swim parallel to the surface. If you don't, you might need a little, who am I kidding, a lot of help to get out of one. Now, you want to talk places to go. Cocoa Beach is definitely one of them. More specifically, Ron John Surf School. And is a really fun place, and they have a cool instructor. His name's Larry. Now, he teaches you the basics and all, but when you get up on that board, he teaches you all this advanced stuff and really cool stuff. I love surfing. It's also easy, but you need to remember what waves to go on, how to correctly stand on your board, and how to be safe. Now, next time you go on vacation, make it a beach vacation. And while you're at it, go surfing and have fun.